Hello, everyone, and welcome to our discussions with the scientists in the Miami Project to Cure Paralysis. My name is Dalton Dietrich, and I'm the scientific director of the Miami Project. And today, we have a special guest with us, Dr. Jacqueline Sagen, who's a professor in the Department of Neurological Surgery at the University of Miami, and a very important component or member of the Miami Project to Cure Paralysis. Jackie, thanks for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, you're very welcome. Jackie has been with us for many, many years working on different aspects of quality of life issues targeting people living with spinal cord injury. And we talked about this before, but today we're going to focus on what Dr. Sagen is doing in terms of neuropathic pain. So Jackie, tell me why neuropathic pain is so important to the to our spinal cord injured community.
Okay, well, I think probably you've already heard from the clinical perspective what Dr. Wiederstrom-Noga has to say. We're looking at it from a preclinical aspect. So in general, we're looking at ways to alleviate chronic pain, sort of more generally in terms of not only spinal cord injury, but also peripheral nerve injuries and things that are not well controlled by current medications. And even if they are marginally controlled, the problem is with, you know, long-term treatment with many medications, there's serious side effects as well as problems with potential abuse and misuse. And so in the spinal cord injury population, the estimates are somewhere close to, I think, 70 or 80% that experience some type of chronic pain. And particularly we're interested in our lab in neuropathic pain, which is due to injury to the nervous system and doesn't really originate necessarily in the peripheral part of your body. And so that it's something that's misunderstood by processing in the nervous system and in the spinal cord and then eventually to the brain where the pain is perceived. And at that point, it's really not something that can be controlled or managed by repairing for example, during a post-surgical, eventually, you know, you would repair and then you wouldn't have to deal with a chronic pain issue per se necessarily, unless there was maybe a nerve injury that was involved as well. So those are the types of pains that were trying to find better ways to manage by doing experimental treatments in our lab.
So the experimental treatments are really directed first at trying to understand the pathophysiology of why you actually would generate abnormal sensation. When most people think about with spinal cord injury, you actually lose sensation.
That's true, and that's actually kind of, in some ways, it's a mystery, you know, because we don't necessarily assume that we're going to be able to measure pain from peripheral stimulation, which makes it a little complicated to test preclinically. But also, it looks like changes happen within the central nervous system, in the spinal cord, which I'll tell you about in a minute, and also in higher centers, the way that the messages are perceived. And so there are several hypotheses, you know, obviously that, and a lot of things that seem to change in the spinal cord that may be similar to sort of a learning process that would happen in higher centers of the brain. But what we think is happening is that because of maybe the loss of normal input or the loss of neurons, let's say in the spinal cord that would normally inhibit, you know, sort of the pain signaling that gets transmitted up into the brain, that we wind up having sort of these foci of abnormal hyperexcitability in the spinal cord and maybe in higher centers as well, that serve to sort of continually give signals that something hurts or something is painful. And we even for example in a phantom limb patient, the limb is not there yet, 90% or so of those patients feel pain in the limb that's not there. So it can't be coming from the periphery. It has to be some abnormal signaling going on in the spinal cord and transmitted to the brain centers.
Mm-hmm. So one of the areas you have many projects going on in your laboratory, you have a very active research group, And one has been for many years, you've been interested in cell therapies. And some of these cell therapies actually involve engineering these neuroprogenitor cells to actually transplant it into release factors that affect some of these mechanisms you just talked about. Could you tell us a little bit more about that?
Okay, so there, you know, one issue, of course, is the choice of cells to use for transplantation. And we have in the past, we actually did some studies in some human terminal cancer patients with a cell called a chromaffin cell, which is something taken from the adrenal gland and was used in old days, you know, many, like in the 80s in Parkinson patients to replace dopamine. But so those cells are secretory cells, and they make things that we know if you inject in the spinal cord directly would reduce pain. But the problem is that those cells are not something you can generate in the lab to reproduce. And so we've turned to neural stem cells, the reason being that you can, in theory, change those cells into other cell types of the body, or, you know, or stem cells in general. But the neural stem cells specifically, we can, they like to sort of, if you leave them untouched and you do a few little things with them, you can turn them into cells that produce an inhibitory transmitter called GABA. Mm-hmm. And we think that part of the mechanism of, you know, one of the underlying problems in spinal cord injury pain, and also even in peripheral neuropathic type pain, is that those inhibitory small GABA cells that are in the sensory processing areas of the spinal cord are particularly vulnerable, and they either die or they stop producing an inhibitory transmitter, or they stop functioning normally. But you can actually see them when you do a spinal cord injury, even at higher levels like thoracic levels. You can look down in the lumbar spinal cord, which is several segments away, and even if you see in there intact neurons and sort of an intact looking neural circuitry, those GABA cells are not lighting up. We don't see them anymore. So we're trying to use those, try to replace those inhibitory cells by taking stem cells, turning them into GABAergic neurons, and transplanting them into those areas to restore the inhibitory neural circuitry. But the other good thing about these cells is that because we can grow them in the lab and they reproduce, we can engineer them to produce other, you know, potential pain reducing agents, which we've been doing. So we've been designing different types of genes that can produce, for example, an excitatory transmitter blocker, which might block the local, that, remember I was talking about that focal hyperexcitability. Right. So we include that in the cell transplant. And we could also include things like their opioid peptides, for example. And if they're locally placed in the spinal cord, and then the cells would secrete them locally, then we don't have this problem with you know, some euphoria and higher level issues and addiction and things like that, because they're local in the spinal cord. And it turns out that many of these things, like the excitatory, and you know, the thing that we're blocking the excitatory transmitter with, plus the opioid, are synergistic. So even low levels of the two of them will work together and produce like a super additive reduction in pain. So yeah, try and put all that together. And
well, that's really exciting and very important, because you just mentioned it, the opioid addiction problem that we have in the United States, many people having pain, and they get on different types of drugs and become addicted to it. And that, of course, severely affects their quality of life. And so these types of strategies that you're using in combination maybe with lower doses of opioids may be able to prevent the addiction that happens in so many people.
And we're actually looking at that exact thing by looking at, so there are ways to you know, you have to ask your preclinical model how they feel or how they respond. And one way to do that is to give them a choice between going into a box that you've trained them, they're going to get a morphine dose or not. And in models that have, you know, higher pain levels, they'll tend to go to that box that, you know, has paired with morphine in their head. But in these animals that we've reduced the pain with transplants and with some of these gene, you know, therapies that I was telling you about, they have much less tendency to go in and seek out the morphine, which indicates that they would have lower pain and probably also less propensity to, you know, seek out opioids, which is a big problem.
Yeah, big problem. So another area that you've shown is actually showing that maybe exercise seems to also affect abnormal sensation.
Now, this to me was actually a surprise, and I had a postdoc in the lab, Elizabeth Dugan, who came in with a background in locomotor training in some of these models, and then also a spinal cord injury pain model, a different one. And when she came in, we thought we'll try it in our model. And it turns out that it depends on the intensity of the exercise, which is going to be something we have to look into in the future. But if with an intensive training for, you know, a period of time, the pain responses that are measurable go down, which is just really interesting. And it looks like it's in part due to a decreased inflammatory, you know, sort of a global inflammatory ongoing response in the spinal cord following injury, as one of the mechanisms. But the other thing that we found was we combined that with some of our neural stem cell transplants. And interestingly enough, the exercise itself, maybe because it produced this reduced inflammatory local response, the transplants themselves survived better. And I mean, there were more GABA cells around. There were more cells that produce, if we engineered the cells, there were more cells that produced the engineered peptides that were pain reducing. And also the cells themselves, there are some markers that show that they're more effective. In other words, they produce better effects on the GABAergic, you know, the inhibitory system itself. So everything kind of worked, you know, together. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so now we have some longer term studies going on where we've looked at animals that are exercising for up to 2 years. And of course we lost, the ones that we lost more in a way are because they didn't do as well because they're not as physically fit, right? Mm-hmm. But the animals that you know that were in this treatment group that were running for 2 years were had their maintained low levels of pain for 2 years.
Mm-hmm. So. Well, that's really interesting. I mean, we know exercise is so good for us for many reasons, and now we've got another reason to exercise. So that's fantastic.
Right. So now the issue is how to translate this more to a clinical type of therapy, and so. A couple of things that we're trying to look at is, you know, whether other types of exercise, because not every patient that has spinal cord injury is going to be running on treadmills, you know, for 3 to 5 days a week. So we're going to look at maybe swimming exercise or a circuit training type of thing. And the other thing, of course, is to generate human stem cell sources, which we're collaborating with the Hussman Institute to try to get now from, you know, ultimately from a patient's own peripheral blood, we should be able to generate GABAergic neurons from there. And so that's where the study's going.
Yeah, I think it's important for our audience to know that many of your studies and most of your studies are always pretty much directed to translation. So the things that you're trying in your preclinical models are very potentially clinically relevant to actually moving into clinical studies and trials eventually.
I hope so. Yeah. Well, we have a good group of potential collaborators, and we've gotten a lot of enthusiasm from
a lot of discussion out there in terms of the use of marijuana in terms of targeting pain. And the state of Florida just recently actually funded yourself, your laboratory, and other laboratories throughout the state to actually look at different types of components of marijuana that actually could be used in a controlled setting. I mean, we have medical marijuana in the state of Florida that could be used to target pain. So you've been very interested in some of the receptors that these compounds can actually interact with. So you tell us about that. I think it's a very interesting science.
So I think, you know, over the years we've looked at different cannabinoid agonists, and it really does look like in at least in spinal cord injury models that the CB1, which is the traditional potent agonist site, is the one that works best for reducing that type of pain, you know, using different pharmacological tools. But that's also the one that there's some concern with side effects, euphoria, you know, those kind of things. There are other, you know, the cannabis has there are so many different components that it may be hard to sort that out. But we've seen also in the literature that CBD, which is it's one that you can, I think you can just buy now, you know, in the store on the street, but it has some pain reducing effects. It's not as potent, clearly, but we feel like, because based on other studies that we've been doing, that if we combine, you know, a low dose of one with a low dose of the other, that they'll be super additive and you know, and synergistic, possibly. And then maybe we can get away from having these potentially adverse side effects while at the same time alleviating the pain. So we're hoping to, you know, get this study off the ground as soon as we're, you know, back in the lab, I hope. But the other thing is that as a side study or as another study, as part of our engineered peptides, we were searching for peptides that would act at these cannabinoid receptors, because then if we find a peptide that can act at those receptors, we can generate a gene that codes for those peptides, and then we could put them in our cells for transplantation, and then it would be local in the spinal cord, and it may solve the problems. So we're looking at it's a, they're marine cone snails, they're fascinating creatures, and they make a whole bunch of unique peptides that act at selective receptors, and there are hundreds and hundreds of them, and maybe more. And so we're screening a bunch of these peptides that are, you know, actually they're components of some of the venom toxins that they make, but they make peptides that actually act at the cannabinoid receptor. And so so we're doing another project, right, to try to sort of isolate, you know, we have to keep doing fractions, subfractions, subfractions until we get to a peptide, and then we're going to generate a gene therapy and hopefully be able to take advantage of the cannabinoid receptor and its potency in reducing spinal cord injury pain.
Yeah, a lot of interesting concepts to follow up on. Right in the middle of the COVID-19 pandemic, how is that affecting your research programs?
Well, as you know, we're keeping as much going as we can, doing social distancing in you know, in the lab, and, you know, only letting one person in at a time. There's some longer term studies that we really, you know, it would have been devastating to terminate them and start all over again. But I think at this point, for the most part, we're you know, we just have a handful of those type of studies ongoing, and the rest of it we're just gonna have to wait, I think. And yeah, in the meantime, I you know, we have our lab going, and they all have assignments there's a ton of data to analyze, and maybe we'll get some papers out, and we're working on some grants, and we're all keeping busy. It's just not ideal, because it's frustrating not to be generating, you know, new data and moving that forward. So
congratulations on all you're doing. I'll just ask one more question. You actually originally came from industry. So how important is working with industry and academia for you in terms of some of the questions you're asking? Do you reach out? Does industry in any way collaborate with your research programs and things of this nature?
I was only, the truth is, I was in industry for a couple of years in between, and okay. It's only, you know, I really consider myself an academic, mostly. And the stint in between was really because of some frustration about not getting our technologies out into the clinic fast enough. And that's always a frustration. And, you know, I'm hoping that we're trying to, you know, work with tech transfer and, you know, get things going with them. And hopefully we, you know, I think that's going to be one of the ways that we really need to get the technology we develop out, you know, and available to everybody, because there's only so much you can do in a preclinical lab, and even in a, you know, we can do limited clinical trials, you know, at UM, but at some point it's really going to take, you know, some safety and development studies, and that those are hugely expensive, and they really have to be done in partnership with industry.
Great points. Thank you. Well, Jackie, thank you very much for spending some time with us today, and congratulations for everything you're doing. I think the areas you're working on are so clinically relevant, and glad that you're using some of the state-of-the-art technology to actually approach this really complicated problem. So thank you very, very much for talking to us.
Thank you. Be well, be safe.
Same to you.